Thank you very much. So since we're going to talk about what all the great people can do, and it's landscape heroes, these are the landscape Avengers that are here today. And as much as that's a joke, I do think that getting the message out is really important, and these people are really doing the heavy lifting to send the message out and get the message out. So I'm going to be focusing a lot on soil biology. Well, what is soil biology? When I was first in the horticulture field, landscape, tree care, soil biology these are all things that I would typically point a spray gun at to kill. So just like an ex-smoker, I'm the worst kind of, in the organic realm, now I really preach and practice what I preach. So as you heard a little bit, some of the slides may be a little redundant, but there'll be a lot of tie-in with this morning. Healthy plants put as much as 80% of the energy that they produce into their root systems. Now, of that 80%, half is put into the soil as exudates. And there was a question: is it for bacteria? Is it for fungi? And it is really for both. The plants, as they grow, they release all these exudates into the soil, and these are things like. We're talking about carbon, so they're high carbon, carbohydrates, sugars, proteins, and these things are, they're basically released out of the root system, and the plant makes a huge investment in growing these, in putting these exudates out to grow beneficial fungi and beneficial bacteria. One of the major functions of the beneficial microbes is that they will create this this shield around the root system, and that shield will protect the root from things like root disease. Okay, it creates actually a barrier. In some cases, that's a physical barrier. In other cases, there are actually antagonistic microbes that. One microbe will attack the other microbe. But basically, that's one of the main reasons the plant puts all this energy into producing these exudates is to feed all these beneficial microbes. To think about, all right, we said it's a lot. It's an awful lot of exudate. It's an awful lot of energy. So in 1 gram or 1 teaspoonful of non-rhizosphere soil, so soil that's not right around that root zone, soil that would be out here, away from the roots. In 1 gram or 1 teaspoonful, you have about 600 million bacteria. And if you put all the pieces of fungi end to end, you would have meters. You could measure out meters of fungal hyphae. But now if you take that same teaspoonful of soil from inside the root zone, in the rhizosphere where all those exudates are, they feed so much bacteria that instead of 600 million, we now have 10 billion. So it's a tremendous amount. And instead of meters of fungal hyphae, there's miles of fungal hyphae. So really a tremendous amount of resource that the plants are putting into the production of exudates. So you've seen this picture. So this is a nematode-trapping fungus right here, okay? And what it does is these little hoops it has, they release exudates as well. And those exudates mimic that of a plant root. And basically what happens is this root-feeding nematode thinks that it has a nice, easy meal in a plant, and it swims through the hoop, and the fungus decomposes the nematode. So these are actually in our soils. They're as long as they haven't been really hammered with chemicals. These are really fairly common. This nematode trapping fungus, and just this is another picture of it. But basically, these hoops release exudates, the nematode swims through, and then that hoop constricts and the fungus decomposes the nematode. Really is pretty cool world under our right under our feet that you really never know about. So bacteria and fungi, these are decomposers. These are things that break down organic matter. Does anyone here ever put down organic fertilizer? Okay, so you're not feeding your plants when you put down that organic fertilizer. What you're feeding are bacteria and fungi. They have to break down the that fertilizer, and then they hold on to all the NPK that's in the fertilizer, and then something else needs to come feed on them to make it plant available. So there's a whole system in play here that these, what we call the soil food web, or all these soil microbes, and there's a way that they process all these things to make it user-friendly for your plants. And obviously your plants are also producing some of that food, you know, through the exudates. So this is a picture of a bacterium, and this kind of sphere, that's the body of the bacterium. These little wings over here, that's a glue layer or a slime layer, and that basically allows bacteria to stick itself to its food resource. This is also where we heard a lot of talk this morning about clean water, about getting that percolation rate, water to percolate. And one of the main functions of the bacteria gluing themselves to their food resource is that they also glue sand, silt, clay, and organic matter together. And they form these micro aggregates. All right, so that's all a function of the glues that the bacteria produce. So the more you feed your soils, not necessarily your plants, but the more you feed your soils, and whether that's through leaf litter, organic fertilizer, compost, whatever you're putting down, mulching your grass clippings, you're feeding bacteria, and one of the primary functions, like we said, was protecting the root system of your plant, but it's also to create these soil aggregates. And the soil aggregates, obviously, will help with percolation, creating really good soil structure. This is really the, you know, the beginning stages of building soil structure. And then what's cool is the, so you've seen this picture, and this is the surface of a corn leaf a couple of weeks after it hit the soil surface, and this is all strands of fungi that's decomposing the corn leaf. And again, it's going to hold on to whatever is in that corn leaf. So any NPK, micronutrients, as well as carbon, is just transferred from one form to another. As simple as, you know, I had a wrap for lunch, and that was a wrap, and now that's part of Paul's biomass. So the same thing with this corn leaf. It used to be a corn leaf, and now it's fungal biomass. So the carbon has just changed forms. And these are things that when we, you know, when we make applications and kill beneficial fungi, we kill bacteria in the soil, we kill other microbes, we're reducing the soil's ability to hold on to NPK, micronutrients, and the like. That's one of the reasons that we don't want to be using pesticides. Sorry, going a little too fast. All right, so the beneficial fungi then will wrap a lot of these micro aggregates to create more of a macro aggregate. And again, it's all that aggregation that the bacteria do and then the fungi do, and that's going to help really build soil structure. And when you get to the point of where you've had a disturbed environment, whether that's a farm or a landscape, and you heard about key liming, what you're actually doing is, you know, part of it is opening that soil back up so that these aerobic microbes can start to rebuild soil structure by creating these aggregates. So this is forest stuff, and you can see all the all this white hyphae in there. And basically, what we try to do is try to mimic Mother Nature as much as we can in a landscape setting or in an agricultural setting. And this is an area where we've basically put a granular microbial food down to recreate that natural environment. We're putting the food resource down, and then we're adding a compost tea or a liquid biological amendment, and we're inoculating beneficial microbes to colonize the food resource and kind of rebuild or mimic that forest floor, you know, as close as we can get to it. So bacteria and fungi, they decompose organic matter, whether that's leaf litter, organic fertilizer, compost, or exudates. They retain all the nutrients and the carbon that was in all that organic matter. And then as they do that, they also build and rebuild soil structure, and they help suppress disease. So the main, you know, nutrient retention, and one of the greatest things in this picture is when you think about putting down an inorganic form of nitrogen, that's typically a very leachable form of nitrogen, okay? Because these bacteria have stuck themselves in place. Bacteria is one of the most concentrated living form of nitrogen in the world. So you have a huge resource of nitrogen that's stuck in place, and so you don't have to worry about as much of the leaching effects from using organic fertilizer than you would with chemical fertilizer. All right, so again, the plants produce exudates and organic matter. Exudates and organic matter feed the bacteria and fungi, and the bacteria and fungi help keep your plants healthy, help retain those nutrients, and they help build soil structure. So now your plants still haven't been fed in this model. You've put your fertilizer down, your organic fertilizer, or your leaf litter, or what have you, your compost. Your bacteria and fungi have retained all those elements that were in those materials. Nothing's been cycled back to the plants yet, and that's where these predatory microbes come in. And those are protozoa, nematodes, and microarthropods. I was having breakfast with Mike Nadeau this morning, who was saying he loves crabgrass. He allows it to, when he's doing a meadow system, that would be one of the species that will help give him some coverage and then is eventually outcompeted. And I want to tell him if he's looking for any helpers, I can grow some great crabgrass. So I was weeding one day and I pulled this out and I thought, I must be doing some really good work on my soil because look at how well structured, look at that soil structure, look at how beautifully uniform the root system is on that. And it's a great picture because all these little nooks and crannies, that's all the little places where protozoa and nematodes really want to hang out, and that's where they are going to function really well. And again, this is something that T spoke about compaction this morning, and when you compact your soil, you will reduce the environment for protozoa, nematodes, and other predatory organisms to live. And what happens, you know, when that happens, people can try and go organic, not realizing they've created a condition where, through compaction, that only really the bacteria and fungi could live a little bit. These guys are not going to be able to be present, the protozoa nematodes, in the amounts that you need to keep your plants healthy. So protozoa are basically bacterial feeders. They make nutrients plant available. So the protozoa feed on bacteria, and then they release the nitrogen that was inside the bacteria, and they make it available to your plants. They also build soil structure, but they do it a little differently than bacteria do. Bacteria created those aggregates, but bacteria aren't very mobile. Protozoa are highly mobile, so as they knock into those aggregates and move soil around, they will be more, instead of passive there, it's a little bit more, you know, aggressive building of soil structure. And then they're also indicators of lack of oxygen. So if you take a look, that's an amoeba. And if you just watch the way the cytoplasm just moves along the top of that microscope slide, you start to realize when these are in your soil, and again, these will feed on bacteria and they release nutrients into plant-available form. So when your soil gets a little on the drier side, it's not holding so much water, the way these guys are set up, they can move along a physical surface very, very well. That's the environment. They can navigate really well. When your soil gets to field capacity or a little even on the dry side, these guys are still functioning to feed on bacteria and provide that steady stream of NPK and micronutrients, all natural, to your plants. One of the other forms of protozoa that we look at are flagellates. Okay, so that's like, this guy's a flagellate. And you could see, you can't really see the, he has a flagellum, so it's kind of like a tadpole, but they're very well adapted to swimming in pools of water. So when I showed you that the crabgrass soil and the those little nooks and crannies after an irrigation, after a rainfall, you'll have little pools of water, and maybe the amoeba are not quite as active then, but the flagellates wake up, and if you know they're going to feed on bacteria as well and return nutrients into plant available form. So the idea is you want to have all these different types of, you want to have great diversity in your soil to make sure that under varying soil conditions, your plants still have that cycle of nutrients, and you have also the all the bacteria and fungi present to, you know, make sure that any nitrogen that your plants don't take up is recolonized by the bacteria, recolonized by the fungi, and then they will hold on to it again. So this guy, this is a ciliate. They feed on anaerobic bacteria primarily. Yeah, he does tricks. He's like a circus performer. So I told you how hard it was to hold the camera on the microscope to, you know, and get this video clip, watching him swim around. But these guys are highly mobile. They basically will, again, they're going to be very aggressive in how they go out and get their food, which is anaerobic bacteria. So generally, we don't like to see these in super high levels in soil, because if your primary form of protozoans are ciliates, that tells us your soil went anaerobic. And what that means is, you know, you probably need to aerate, you need to, you know, improve that soil structure. So they are a great indicator, but they are also very beneficial in the way that anaerobic bacteria will produce 15 to 25 parts per million alcohol just as a byproduct. And the average plant root can tolerate about 1 part per million alcohol. So if you see a lot of these guys there, that can tell your soil's going anaerobic and you probably have some sort of, you know, alcohol production killing your root system. So the nice thing is, if these guys are there, they're helping clean your soil up. You want to have them there to feed on that anaerobic bacteria and to reduce all those anaerobic byproducts. So your anaerobic soil, alcohol and other nasty compounds around roots that can kill roots. Beneficial fungi will have a really hard time tolerating anaerobic soil. Some disease causers can tolerate anaerobic soil. So disease-causing fungi will do a little better in that environment than beneficial fungi. So as your soils get compacted, you're selecting for disease causers to, you know, kind of have their way with the plants. And the other thing is, as just I'll give you one example, ammonium can turn to ammonia in anaerobic soil and be lost to the atmosphere. So if you have a compost that went anaerobic, it's probably nitrogen deficient because it went, you know, it went up into the atmosphere. When your soil goes anaerobic, the same thing. You have the nutrients become volatile and in many cases are lost. So just for size comparison, there's a nematode, there's a ciliate. These would be your flagellates. Bacteria are, you know, maybe 1/10 the size of a flagellate. So just so you, for thinking about that soil structure and size comparison, there you have it. So nematodes, although we said protozoa will feed primarily only on bacteria, nematodes feed on a whole group of different critters. Some of them feed on bacteria, some of them feed on fungi. Bad guys, root-feeding nematodes, feed on plants. Then you have insect parasitic nematodes, and you have predatory nematodes. These guys build soil structure, and again, they are, they're larger, much larger than the bacteria and fungi. They burrow through the soil just like earthworms, so they have a very positive impact on soil structure. T already showed you this, but just to let you know how sad my life is, this is an acroboles. I know the name of this guy. It means I don't get out too much. So this is a predatory nematode feeding on a root-feeding nematode. So you'll, again, when you get your soil food web healthy, you have all sorts of pest control built right into the system in the way of the beneficial microbes. So now thinking about, you know, how much nutrient cycling actually happens. In a healthy landscape soil, this is not one that you're composting three times a year, just a general healthy landscape soil, you can retain 10 to 15 pounds of nitrogen per 1,000 square feet. And protozoa nematodes can cycle 2.5 pounds of N per 1,000 square feet per month, as long as the ground's not frozen. This is in just a regular healthy soil system. And what I point out is, if you can count on about, roughly 10 months when the ground's not frozen, so that's, you know, that's 25 pounds of N. That's, 10 months, 2.5 pounds a month that these guys are turning over. That's 25 pounds of N per 1,000 square feet. If you compare that to even a very highly managed, a lawn that's highly managed, a lawn care program, you're talking about five times or more the amount of nitrogen that you would put down on the lawn care program. But if you just take care of your soil, it's automatically built in. You just keep your soil healthy. Landscape soils also, and this is a landscape soil. This is not a forest where you have much, much more life. But you can have 2 to 5,000 pounds of microbial carbon. That's just the amount of carbon that is sequestered in the bacteria and fungi, protozoa, and nematodes in an acre. So your microarthropods. So now we've talked about everything that spends the majority of their time or all their time below ground. Microarthropods are higher level predators. So these guys will, they will also produce some nutrient cycling. They also build soil structure, and they're much larger now than the other critters. If you just take a look, there's a fungal feeding mite. There's a nematode. Grain of sand. So you just for size comparison and thinking about that impact on soil structure, what the difference is with these microarthropods. So there's your one of your shredders will also feed on fungi, but they're breaking organic matter down so that the your bacteria and fungi can also break it down further. And then this is the kind of just a diagram. You know, your plants produce the exudates and the organic matter in the leaf tissue. Bacteria and fungi are the first level, the decomposers. Then you have your predators, and then your higher level predators. So it's a whole, again, it's a food web, but basically everything starts with that bacteria, fungi, protozoa, and nematodes. That's the start of it all. Thinking about blending your organic matter to much deeper levels earthworms. This is a corn leaf. Everybody knows how large a corn leaf is that an earthworm has kind of taken down into its burrow. And just think about the mixing of organic matter, how far down that will go. With all these tunnels that the earthworms make and to bring organic matter much further down. This is a landscape I worked on this year, and here you go with, there's the site soil where the tree came from, which used to be up here, little mulch layer, and it's all those microarthropods that have blended that organic matter and brought it down to that depth, and that should continue. But that's, you know, that's a few inches in a year of soil building, and it builds a much larger plenum for you know, nutrients to be held in the soil and for roots to grow at, you know, at a very nice environment. Just kind of wrapping it up. So a forest, thinking again about that carbon, a forest will drop about 4,000 pounds of leaves per acre per year. That is the system, all those microbes, that's the whole system to process that and keep it in the soil. So why are we cleaning our leaves up in a landscape? Leave them and let the system work. Love them and leave them. And then just a quick note on compost tea, or as T. Fleischer says, liquid biological amendment. One of the great things about actively respiring microbes will also give off carbon dioxide. When you get them on the leaf surface, it will actually improve the fitness for photosynthesis for the plants. So the plants are going to take in that CO2, assimilate the carbon. Compost tea can be a very valuable tool in the landscape just as a foliar amendment to aid in photosynthesis. These were from North Creek Nursery, but just a couple of great examples. They always grew these and sold them just fine. They happened to do a few trials with compost tea versus fertilizer. And just look at the, you know, look at the difference. You know, and then the thought is, where is more carbon sequestered? That one for sure. You can see that's the compost tea trial. They're flipped in the next picture. Here's the compost tea trial. But look at the difference in the root system. So much, much more carbon sequestered, and I would attain, you know, I would attribute some of that to the, you know, aiding the CO2, the plants in taking up CO2 with that on the foliage. And I would just say the more layers you have, if you think about a forest, you know, again, we're just trying to mimic Mother Nature. So whether you're farming, you're landscaping, but the more of this, you know, the more green layers you have, the better chance you have of trapping that carbon as it comes, you know, out of the earth and is assimilated into the these trees and is held into the landscape. So I'm going to finish there, and I'll be around until the panel for any questions. Thank you.